Balogun of Ekpe Land, former governorship candidate in Lagos State, a chieftain of the All Progressive Congress APC, chairman and managing director at Righteous Construction Company, a one-time commissioner for public transport in Lagos State. Here is an exclusive interview with Chief Larry Razak.
Very, very pretty fine.
Thank you so much. I can see that from your smile, sir. It is really nice having you. Now, sir, let's tell my viewers who want to meet you and how far you've been coping, and from your own little, what God has been giving you, we're still able to give back to the society, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
My name is Chief Larry Razak, the Balogun of Ekpe, and a chieftain of APC. That's my political party. Well, I want to thank God for His wonderful grace, mercies, kindness, generosity to me in the last 71 years that I've been in existence. I want to thank God that He's been kind to me. He's been extremely kind to me. You can imagine if you buy a vehicle that you continue to run every day. For a period of 71 years, I am afraid that vehicle may not be on the road again.
Yeah, right, sir.
And God has allowed me to remain on the road for 71 years, and I don't have anything to regret. And I want to thank my God for that wonderful gift of life. Well, I went to school, ordinarily you will know that, and I've been in the political terrain of Nigeria. I was a UPN, SDP, NROC period. I was the chairman of SDP in a political government. That's Babangida's party, no joiner, no finder, we are co-joiners, co-finders. After that, we have APP, where I became the state chairman and later the deputy national chairman of the party, with Yusuf Ali as my chairman. After some time, I left for PDP, thinking I needed a broader platform that can actualize my political dreams. But surprisingly, I discovered that party completely rotten. And I left the party about 7 years ago, when I knew that they don't have the intention of the people. And by our upbringing, political student of Chief Obafemi Awolowo, we are to ensure we give the greatest goods to the greatest number of people in the society. We don't just come around and we are in politics because we want to benefit from the economic benefits of the situation, no. And about 7 years ago I left, I jumped up to Nambu Strong CN, and I was quite happy. I'm a member of that party, and we jointly collapsed all the party into structure that we now call APC because of the merger. And I want to thank God that I was part of that program. Merger had never succeeded in this country, but with committed, dedicated, patriotic leadership of Bola Ahmed Tinubu, that thing survived because he really sacrificed a lot to ensure the success of that arrangement. And it was so good, I'm happy I'm still here.
Wow. Now, sir, you were once a PEP local government chairman,
yes.
And with our founders, you did a lot, and you, even from your own personal form, how were you able to achieve that, sir?
Yes, like I told you, I'm a student of Awo's political belief, philosophy. Awo believes that you must leave the state better than you met it. And he believes in the egalitarian society. He believes that you must provide the greatest number of goods to the greatest number of people. He believes, as a leader, primarily, you must create confidence in your followers. And you must let them know you are ready to improve the lot of their lives and that of their property, so that they can have a better situation in the world. So with this, When I got to the council, I was able to build 350 housing units within a period of 9 months. It was like a magic, everybody never believed. It's there for you to have to do. A program at school is tracing the housing estate. The council is calling, tracing it from very close to the fire service stations in Nepal. It's a unique development, and everybody was happy about it. Now government is talking about rice plantation. Then in 1994, I was able to decide that I must produce sufficient rice for the people of the division. Of course, their problem is, how do they get enough money to do their farming? You may not believe it. The farmers were just looking for 10,000 to cultivate and plant rice, and use their personal labor to ensure they watch the rice grow and protect it from birds and the harvest. So I met the People's Bank MD then, the Shoketo, and I told her, I have about 600 people who wants to do farming.
Okay.
And their need is 10,000.
Wow. The 10,000 at that time, sir.
Yes, yes. Okay. And they just smiled. They say, what do you intend to do about that? I say, I want her to give us 600,000. I will guarantee personally, and the local government will be made to guarantee that loan, because I'm sure my people will repay. So he granted my request, and the money was provided. And the farmers, real farmers, got the money. And surprisingly, I was able to, from the council fund, provide rice milling machine. So for them, so at the end of the harvesting period, they produced that what their market cannot absorb.
Wow.
And then they ran to me that, Chief, you had supported us financially, and at the end of the harvest period, we have this much, and our market cannot absorb it. What do you do to help us? So that all that we planted that is available now, our harvest don't just wasted. I said, okay. I bought it over from them at a really, with a little markup to make them happy. They were to sell in the market for 5,000. I give it them at 8,000. They were calling very happy. With that, all of them, without exception, were able to pay off the loan of the People's Bank within just a period less than a year. They were so happy and excited. And we have a clean rice. The rice the council bought, we put it back to the market again at a real subsidized rate. And the community were very happy. They were happy, very, very happy. And they charmed the Kuben's rice then, and they were buying the
local rice.
Obada Igbogun's rice. And it was good. It was good, very, very nourishing rice. So we did that. We improved the infrastructure of the area. And the government was highly impressed. In actual fact, the Minister of National Planning came to my local government when he saw those publications in the paper. He never thought it could be reality. He thought we were making the usual, the more you look, the less you see kind of situation. He came, he saw them. He was really happy. And from there, I was taken to the Minister of Public Transportation, and I made a commissioner for public transportation. And I played my role. I was able to convince Alhaji Jakande that we don't need a toll gate at this toll gate at 7 o'clock. Because for whatever money you are collecting, what the people are wasting in terms of man are wasted daily as a result of the traffic in that area,
yes,
does not really worth it. The entire community was barricaded off. We were put in a channel. Until you get to that toll gate, you cannot get out. So that had a serious effect on Akume Road, always serious transport problem, traffic problem all the day. When all this Magudu area, they are always a standstill kind of traffic situation. The situation at that toll gate area was so terrible. And everybody was happy that we were able to eliminate about it. Then we were able to get railways to transport people from Alagbado Yaba, Apapa, Edo, every day. We're equally
does it. Wow.
We're able to again synchronize the three modes of transportation in Lagos. That is the transportation on buses, the transportation on the railway, and water. We started what is now very popular to have people move from Maitu to Apapa to Marina. And we move people from Ikorodu, Bayeku, Ibugu, Ijede to Osborn area. And it removed a lot of money having wasted on daily basis. And everybody was happy. And those are the things that makes me happy that I've been able to move out, remove the stress from the people, and they have improved their livelihood by saving a lot of money, having wasted daily on the traffic jam. So I'm happy.
Wow.
And to remain serious, very, very strong till today. And some people don't believe I'm this much of age because I still perform a lot of exercises.
It's very nice, sir. Sir, it's so, so nice having you to say all this, and we appreciate you. Now, quickly, sir, let's quickly talk about the APC administration, national and state a little. What do you have to say about it?
People will not be able to appreciate Buhari's government.
Why?
Because if the bad government of the PDP had continued, maybe some people will have checked out like Andrew out of this country. But because Buhari team simply assisted and induced by our own Bola Ahmed Tinubu and their team to drive out the inefficient government of Jonathan, one may not be able to appreciate. And of course, he's at a corruption drive. You can see the result is yielding. Can you imagine having money all over the places? In Lagos, in luxury flats, in Burundi Shenchok, in marketplaces in
Malibu. Like they said.
So, it's a government that is really restoring hope, dignity of labor, acceptability all over the world. And though one will sympathize with the government that as they are fighting corruption, corruption is qualifying the government to destroy. But I'm happy that when the going is really tough, tough people keep on going. Buhari team, they are very strong and they keep on going. And I'm sure they will defeat the corruption team.
They see complaint daily basis talking about that things are not going well. There's increment in everything. The fuel one is out of it. Even the foodstuffs. You go to the market today, you find out what you used to buy for maybe 100 naira is now maybe 300. So what do you have to say about that area of it?
Maybe they are not facing the reality. The reality is very clear. Then we are selling our crude oil for $100. $130 at the time per barrel. Today, Buhari administration started at $20 per barrel. If your salary used to be 5,000 per month and suddenly reduced to 500 naira per month, there will be changes in your life. You won't be able to meet your want, not even your need. You cannot meet it. So if Buhari could adjust because of the sudden situation we found ourselves, we could be able to adjust, and we are this far. Let's give glory to God. Let's have some little patience, we'll be there.
Okay, sir. Now, sir, let's talk about the social life. That's where I really want you to, you know, talk about how do you relax? What makes you happy after the stressful working day? How do you relax to keep yourself happy?
Okay, hard work, no play. Make Jack a dog boy. Jim, could you call it there? Not only the yeah. Every 7 days of the week, by 5 a.m. I'm already out of bed. By 7, I'm in my office, working through. But I create time for relaxation. I belong to a few clubs. I belong to a book club, island club, and a cook club. Out of the days, I chair some hours in the evening of Tuesday, Thursday, Friday to relax. I go a clubbing during this time and chat and crack jokes with my friends and colleagues so that I take off the stress from my life, and it's really rewarding. By the time we finish that around 7 or 8, I go home, hear the 9 o'clock news, take a good shower and go to bed. So the following day I'm a strong person and I continue life again. But I ensure I spend quality time on my job and quality time on my relaxation and rhythm.
Do you do any sport? Do you have any? What is your best?
No. With this age, I don't do sport. But I do a lot on my treadmill at home.
Okay.
I do 20 minutes on the treadmill every morning.
Okay.
And that keeps me strong. And I recommend it to other people. But be sure you take a very careful look at your strength. Don't overstress yourself so that you don't collapse. I started with 5 minutes when I started it. So graduated along the line 5, 6, 7 minutes the second day. Now I do 25-30 minutes.
I saw you dancing at your birthday party. Tell me, you love dancing or the music that makes you dance?
Yes, there is no music that I cannot dance. Music has a universal language that everybody that loves it will understand. But above that, it's an opportunity to exercise yourself. Those who created dancing must have a deep thought that doing that will give you an opportunity to really stretch yourself and exercise your body. So it's a good thing, and I do dance a lot. Especially when I listen to good music.
Like.
And especially my dear Sunny Ade music.
Uh-huh.
I really helped out my mom. But there is one he did that I always remember. When stationery stores was recent, real stationery stores. And they had a play in Stadium, National Stadium in Ghana. And before they finished the match, Sunny Ade had waxed the music at least 5 minutes. And it came out that he predicted secondary saw will win the match. Kato Chejupe, Otigwe Konwole, Kato Tumbojuwenye, Onutigwe Konwole. Oh my God. When you listen to, and this one, Iwaju Lolo Komiwa Milo, Eyisha Lolo Komiwa
Milo.
Some of this music is philosophical and very, very, very good rhythm to listen to. You enjoy it.
Wow. Thank you so much, sir, for all the time you have spent with us. But sir, before we leave, we want you to advise our youth who are looking up to you and also looking up to leaders out there, a little advice for them, and especially also to the parents who leave their children to roam about the street at a very tender age, sir.
Well, one thing is very critical in life, and that is learning. Who is tired of learning is tired of life. From your small age as a youth until you become old and pass on in that biological sequence, you must continue to learn. My advice to the youth is that there is no alternative to education. There is need for you from time to time to learn, to be educated. Once you are educated, half of your problem has been resolved. Because you can sit down and think of how to make yourself useful to yourself and your living and useful to the society. So education is key to whatever you want to do. And there is no alternative to it. And I appeal to them. They are the leaders of tomorrow. And those who want to give it to them are ready to give it, whether they like it or not. You either become old age and get out of it, or sickness, get out of it, or you misbehave, you get out of it. And if all these things happen, who are those to take over? They are the youth. and they should prepare themselves and they should be ready to take over from the elders who are going away. And I will appeal, they should not hasten them out of the stage. They should allow them to guide them and advise them and really talk and show them the way to do it right. So that will help them a lot rather than hasten them out.
Sir, sorry, I just need to say this because of what the little fact you have occupied like two various public positions. Now, sir, I want you to also talk to some of our leaders out there that still have the opportunity to sit. Just advise them. You know, you give up from the little you have so that you'll be appreciated. And those who is looking up to you, they will say, we'll have a good leader. From the little you have done, can you just please also talk to our leaders out there too?
Next, like Chief Obafemi Awolowo will remain in the minds of Nigerians till eternity. And names like Abacha will look at, like those who have the opportunity now to put their names as looters of our economy, their names will equally remain. And people will be cursing their family and their generation yet unborn. It's good to be good. And even in the Bible and the Quran, for all the good things you do, there is always a reward. And all the bad things you do, you will not go unpunished. The punishment is not only here. When they are there, after their death, they still continue to suffer for making people to suffer. Can you imagine a woman who stole so much from pensioners, who had labored to serve this country, and in their old days, instead of them to get a stipend, their pension, and have a good life, this woman denied them by stealing all the money. Can you imagine somebody went to church and paid 10% tithe and they stole the money, which amounted to 60 million. 60 million. Yeah? And our churches are accepting such money. Without querying a typist in the ministry, how do you come about giving an offering of 60 million, which is just 10% or 5% of the earnings, whatever he's been able to steal and keep in his house, which will go back to the core values of life so that people can really appreciate what it is. When you really have a big man around, you know he has labored for it. When you have a chief around, you know he had worked to qualify him to have that chieftaincy title. And those are the things I would advise are you to always want to embrace.
Yes.
Today, we hit the road again with the Executive Secretary of Odedungu Local Government, Mr. Munshir Mustafa. In the course of our movement, we met this young boy of about 12, hawking bottled water in early hours of the day. As usual, we confronted him to know why he's not in school. He said, there's no money to sponsor him. We accompany him to see his mother, an old woman who also hawked. She shared her predicament with us and the reason why the boy is not in school. At the end of the exercise, the ears of Odedungu Local Government, Mr. Munshir Mustafa, wrote a letter to the head teacher of one of the public schools in the local government to grant the young boy an immediate admission. The ears also paid for his uniform and books.